without any break, I invite the leading archaeologist of the foundation, Archaeological Park Bosnian Pyramid of the Sun, to come forward, Dr. Sara Acconci.
Dobar dan. Kako ste ba? Ja sam nervozna. Well, good afternoon, everybody. Before continuing with the presentation of the new structures we have found in underground tunnels, I would like to speak about my personal experience, because actually when the conference started, it was my first chance to speak about my job. It was the first chance to show you my results, to show you the pictures, because since I signed the contract, it was amazing. My rights to speak about my job, my rights to show my pictures, immediately they disappeared. Nobody wanted to listen to me. So, it was amazing for me when this conference started, because I was very excited. I had the chance to speak with almost all of you, and I had scientists who wanted to listen to me and who wanted to look at my presentation. So, when I'm telling you thank you, it's really from my heart, because you're giving me the chance to speak about my job and my passion. A few words about my personal experience. Why? Not because it's maybe interesting, but just because before the lunch we had the chance to listen to many examples about the ignorance there is at the base of our scientific community. And now I'm standing in front of you. I consider myself as a scientist, and unfortunately I'm one of these examples. I decided to become an archaeologist when I was 5 years old, and I can remember that I was asking my mother, how can I become an archaeologist? And she told me, well, Sara, you will never be able to become an archaeologist, it's a hard job, and well, you know, you cannot find a job so easily. But I said, no, I want to go on and follow my passion and my heart. And I did so. So I started to read a lot of books. And even if I was not studying at the time archaeology in the Milano University, I could see that something was not working, because I was reading a lot of books, and in the same time I started to read books about the so-called alternative history, forbidden archaeology. And well, for me it was amazing. It was a shock, because well, I was reading the documentation, I was seeing the pictures, the artifacts, and I couldn't understand why the scientific community didn't want to accept these artifacts, these new discoveries. And so, well, I was thinking, maybe Sara, you're not studying archaeology yet, so maybe you cannot understand. So I started to study in Milano University. And well, I can remember my first day, I was so excited. I was thinking, university is the center of the culture, so I will go and I want to be like a sponge. I want to learn as much as I can. I want to read books. I want to speak with the professors. And, well, after a few months, unfortunately, I discovered that it was not like this. I discovered that I couldn't speak with my professors because nobody wanted to speak with me. When I was asking questions, their answers were always, well, it's written like this. Why do you want to know? Or during my exams, I wanted to try to have a conversation with them in order to understand what was going on. And their answers were always the same. You don't have to ask, it's written like this. So I was very, very depressed and frustrated, because, you know, I just want to learn and to, you know, discover the truth, because I'm really convinced that we cannot understand our present and our future without realizing what was our past. So I was really close to leave the university, and I was thinking, and suddenly I said, okay, no, Sarah, you have to go on, because the only chance is to understand their game, to understand how they are playing their game, and after that with a piece of paper, because in this world we need the piece of paper in order to speak, to have the possibility to speak, you will be able to play with your own rules. And that's what I did. So I continued to study my faculty. I obtained these two graduations, so now I'm Doctor of Archaeology, and I have this piece of paper, so necessary in this world. And last summer I obtained this job. So I left my job in Italy, I left everything, I was working with universities, okay, I don't want to work with you anymore, and I decided to come here, now I'm living here. So, my experience here in Bosnia, what happened? Last summer, I was a little bit skeptical about the existence of pyramids here. Not because I'm close-minded, but just because, I was reading a lot of things on the internet, and you can find a lot of stuff, and you don't know what is true and what it's not. So, I said, okay, if I really consider myself as a scientist, the only thing I can do is to go and check by myself. So I did it, and I came here as a volunteer for 2 months. And actually, I needed very few days, just the time to check all the structures and all the buildings we have here, in order to be convinced. And I totally fell in love with the project. And so, thanks to Samir Osmanagic, I was in the right place in the right moment, maybe. He was searching for an archaeologist, and he asked me to become the archaeologist of foundation. So I have to thank him so much, because it's because of him if now I'm living my dream, and if now every morning I can wake up and smile, because really I consider myself the luckiest person in the world. So since I signed the contract, a lot of colleagues from Italy and from all around Europe started to write to me, and they were telling me, Sarah, you're crazy, what are you doing? And I was answering them, I'm excavating the biggest and the oldest pyramid in the world. And they were telling, no, nothing exists there in Bisaco, so you're just wasting your time. And other colleagues started to write to me, don't come back to Italy, because you will never be able to find a job as an archaeologist anymore. So my answer was, okay, I don't need to come back. If I will have the chance, I will stay for all my life here in Bisaco. So thank you so much for your support. Thank you for your cooperation. But if you think like this, you can just stop writing me. And I'm receiving a lot of attacks. You cannot imagine. I was simply a student of archaeology. And suddenly, a lot of people started to write against me on the internet. And that's the reason why I'm not checking the internet anymore. And, it's true. Unfortunately, the scientific community is fighting against this project, and they're not doing anything in order to help us. So, from an archaeological point of view, I was here. I can tell you that we have, and you can tell better than me because you were there and you had the chance to visit the different locations, that we have enough evidence in order to say that we have pyramids here. The underground labyrinth is amazing. So I'm just inviting here colleagues, but nobody wants to come. So some of you, I can remember the first day of conference, came to me and they shake my hand. Oh, congratulations, because you ruined your career before you even started. Yes, it's true. But I don't mind. I just want to be here and to try to apply the scientific methodology in this project. And that's the reason why now I will present you the new discoveries we have done inside Ravne Tunnels. So, my presentation will be divided in two parts, principal parts. In the first part, I will speak about the new structure discovered this summer with GeoRadar. So it's the structure Paolo De Bertoli presented to you before me. And in the second part, I will present the new empty sections located at the beginning of December 2010. Okay, next slide. Okay. So, this map, just to remind you, if you can remember here where we have the white arrows, we can find the structure. And well, on Monday you had the chance to visit the tunnel. So if you can remember where we have the monolith, X-shaped monolith, okay, you have just to go on the left, and this is the tunnel with the new structure. And this is the structure. So when you're walking inside the tunnel, you have to imagine, try to use your imagination. The structure is totally on the left. And I'm telling you this because, well, when we had to start excavation, of course we had to have a first plan in order to excavate. So just remember that the structure is totally on the left side of the tunnel. Okay, next. Okay, so that's the structure we have found. And now we'll speak about the original plan, what we did, what kind of problems we encountered. A new plan and new discoveries. Well, that's very recent, 10 days ago. So I added the slides yesterday. So, next. Okay, that's the first scratch of my original plan. As I told you, the structure is totally on the left side of the tunnel. So, my purpose was to excavate on the right side. Why? Can you come back just a second? Okay, we cannot excavate the structure from the top because we don't want to take the risk to ruin the structure. So, out of discussion. And we cannot even excavate from the sides. Okay, maybe I don't know if you understand how we can look at the structure. You have to imagine that we are walking in the tunnel, we are cutting the tunnel in the middle, okay, and we are looking the structure from the front side. So we are now in front of the structure, and that's the vertical section. So when I will speak about the vertical section, just remember that perspective. So, we cannot even excavate on the sides because, as you can see, we don't know exactly what kind of structure we would find, but maybe this structure will collapse, so we cannot take this risk. And that's the reason why, okay, next. And that's the reason why I wanted to excavate on the right side of the tunnel, creating steps. So what it means, the structure is, okay, here in the middle for 2 meters, and I wanted to enlarge the excavation for other 6 meters or even 8 meters, we have to see. 3 meters here and 3 meters here in order to start to go deep because we have to reach minimum 4 meters. We don't know actually what we will find. The geo-radar gives us some information, but as Paolo the Baptist told you, with the water sometimes we can have some problems because you can see the reflection of the structure. So we don't know exactly what we will find. So, that was the purpose. And what did we do? We started to excavate. Here we have some volunteers. We started to excavate. Why? Because, it's even this very interesting. Because, as I told you, no archaeologists are interested in the project. But since we found this structure, a lot of people are writing to me, oh, you're too young to excavate this structure. So just leave everything and we will come to excavate. I'm sorry. So, we started to excavate, but we knew that in the 1960s, well, people from Visoko needed water outside. So they opened this small section of the tunnels, just the first 90 meters, and without taking care about anything. Nobody, of course, was speaking about pyramids, nobody was speaking about underground tunnels. So, in order to have the water outside, they knew that inside it was full of underground water. And they decided to clean partially the tunnels, to put the pipes, in order to create a drainage system, in order to have water outside. So we started to excavate in order to replace these pipes. And which problems did we encounter? Well, actually, we discovered that these pipes were totally, well, maybe we're good for the purpose to have water outside, but for our purpose we're totally wrong. Because as you can see from this picture, they are full of holes. And we have sections of pipe. And these pipes were not even connected anymore. So, what's the problem? A lot of people were writing on the internet that I destroyed with a pick the pipes, and that's the reason why we had problems with the water. A lot of problems told me that I was not looking for the documentation. So they're trying to find all the ways in order to attack me, but it's not a problem. The truth is that, as you can see from the picture, the pipes were full of holes and were not even connected anymore. So, what's the problem? Now, I did this scheme in order to explain you better. That's a vertical section of the pipes. Here in the middle we have the pipe, and here we have the layers. Of course, they are not really like this, but... So, that's the channel created in order to place the pipes. And that's the clay layer. Well, this clay layer is very, very important. Why? Because actually, we always find clay inside the tunnels. But in that case, we found 10 meters of clay layers. And it's the first time we are finding 10 meters of clay layers. So hard and strong. So maybe that can be a possibility. It's possible that, well, of course they knew about the underground water. And clay is waterproof, so in order to protect the structure from the water, they decided to surround the entire structure with a clay layer. So what happened? When in the 1960s they opened this, they created this channel in order to place the pipes, they destroyed the clay layer, the original clay layer. And they decided to cover, of course, everything with other material. But these other materials are not waterproof. So when we opened, when we started to dig, what we discovered? We discovered that the water was everywhere except inside the pipe. So we had to put out the sections of pipes because they were full of holes, they were not connected anymore. And so, next please. So we decided, that's another vertical section, the structure is here in the middle. So we decided to replace the pipes here, plus build two cement walls in order to protect the channel from the water. Because of course we cannot, we have to work in a dry, totally dry place, we cannot do something else. We cannot take the risk to destroy the structure. So that was the new plan. So next, okay, as you can see, we moved the pipes, we have the water, and the water, consider that, well, Ravne tunnels are amazing, because if we have to empty the tunnels, there is no problem from an archaeological point of view. We have the fill of material. It's very easy to recognize. Somebody's telling us that we are creating actually the tunnels, but, well, as you have the chance to see, there is the fill of material very, very, very clear. The consistency is different, the color is different, so we're not creating anything. So if we have to excavate normally the tunnels, it's okay. But in that case, if we have to go deep, it's impossible, because we have underground water, the water is coming from the walls, it's amazing. So we replace, next, like replace the pipe, we decided to build these cement walls, next one, and we started to recover everything, because my original plan, the structure is here, exactly in that position. My original plan was to excavate here on the right in order to have the steps to go down and see the structure from the front, but obviously with all this water it was impossible. So we decided to recover everything, and we started to excavate a tunnel in front of the structure in order to create enough space to be able to go deep. But whatever. Next. Okay, we started to look to dig the tunnel, the fill of material. Here you can see the connection between the main tunnel where the structure is and the tunnel excavating. Okay. But when we started to remove the fill of material, 10 days ago we discovered this new structure. And that's the structure that was mentioned by Debbie, the volunteer who was speaking 2 days ago. She was working here, she was waiting so much, I don't know if she's here, and after that we found this structure. And it's the first time we find a structure like this, because actually, other than to the next... Okay, it's a circular, very small chamber room, as you want to call it, with a pile of stones in the middle, and in the beginning we found the pile of stones, with this bigger one, with this triangular shape. And after that we continued to remove the fill up material, and we discovered that there were other, next one, okay. We discovered that there are six side tunnels with drywalls that are creating actually the small round chamber. So it's a very new discovery. Of course we cannot go deeper now because I don't want to remove these structures. So what we will do in the future? In the future, if we want to excavate the structure, we have to solve the problem with the water for sure. We did it in the main tunnel, but now we will start to go deep and we will start to create and assess like an ancient dromos for the structure. So in that way we will have enough space to try to fix problems, future problems. So we will see. As I told even to some journalists, I'm not scared to tell you I don't know. The problem with the scientists nowadays is that it's very hard to admit that we don't know something. And that's the reason why they're writing a lot of things without any sense. But I'm not scared, so I'm telling you. Here in Visoko, for an archaeologist, well, it's just the best situation to become crazy. Because we don't have answers. We are every day we're finding new questions without answers. And all the things I've studied before, I can take all the books and put them in the garbage. Because really here, everything is unique. So, I don't know. This is a new structure. We found it 10 days ago, and we will see. In the next days, I don't know exactly when, because the volunteering camp will finish on Saturday, so we will see what will happen. We will go on with the excavation and I will let you know something. So, go on. Next? Okay. Now, again the map, just to show you, as you, if you can remember, I told you in the beginning that I will speak even about the new empty sections we found in December 2010. So here is the beginning of the these empty tunnels. Okay, next. Okay, that's what we have found in the beginning of December 2010. We were excavating, so we were removing the material, the fill-up material. Even here you can see, you have the shape of the tunnel, conglomerate, and you have the fill-up material. And suddenly we noticed that there was a hole. We could see inside and everything was empty. So we continued to enlarge the hole and look, everything is totally empty. So even if every day when we are excavating, we're trying to keep the original shapes of the tunnel because of course, we're working in archaeological sites, sometimes we have to enlarge a little bit for safety reasons because we have to put the wooden supports. But in that case, it's amazing, because everything was empty. So we really had the opportunity, the chance to see the original shape of the tunnels. So here you can see there is a tunnel that goes on the right, and there is another tunnel that goes on the left. So, okay, that's the tunnel on the left, okay. Well, I will focus my presentation on the tunnel on the right, because that's the, well, the one with amazing structures. That's the beginning of the tunnel on the left. It follows the southeast direction. And, well, after 42 meters, we found the end. The characteristic of these tunnels, empty tunnels, is that we don't have fill-up material, but actually we have water. So, in this side tunnel, this left tunnel, we found some water on the floor, but maximum 25 centimeters. And after 42 meters, we found the end of the tunnel. But now, in the next slides, I will present you what we have. Another click.
It should appear a white circle.
Can you press? No, it doesn't work. Okay. Yes. So we will focus our attention on this tunnel. That's the one that goes on the right. And as you can see, it's more longer than the other one. And we will see what kind of structures we can find inside. So, it works. So, if you can remember, these tunnels are the ones in the end of the tunnel. So when you visited the tunnels, in the end of the tunnel there were two tunnels with the lights and you couldn't go inside. So I will present to you now what you can find inside. So, next. Okay, that's the first drywall you can find on the right side of the tunnel. And, well, as you can see, it's a pretty normal drywall, if we want to call it like this, because it's, well, pretty similar to all the other drywalls we have ever found inside Ravne Tunnels. So, we have the drywall, we have the fill of material till the top, and behind the drywall, there is another tunnel. You can see perfectly, right? The shape of the tunnel. Okay, but after this, you continue to walk, there is the water, 15-20 centimeters, and after this curve, you can start to see these amazing structures. So, we have drywalls on the right side. The next one, I have some pictures. Okay. Just to underline, there are archaeologists and geologists talking to me that these are natural deposits. So, just to underline what kind of people are inside scientific community. So, left, on the left, next picture. So here you can see, left one, right one, and the next one, all together. So, as you can see, the tunnel is not so big. So I have even in my mind there is the idea that maybe these tunnels were not created in order to walk inside. And but we will discover. For sure, these different heights of the tunnels are helping because of the circulation of air. It's a physical law. So it can be one of the reasons, but look, I'm standing there and I have to walk like this. So you can walk in the middle of these drywalls, and as you can see, these drywalls are totally different from all the other drywalls we have ever found inside the Ravne Tunnel, because they seem, you can see, they seem to be like a support for the ceiling. Actually, we don't have fill-up material behind, so I don't think we will find other tunnels behind these drywalls. They really seem to be a support for the ceiling, or maybe a filter for the water, because in the beginning, where we were, when we didn't have the chance to go deeper, well, we didn't know what was coming. We just knew that there was water. So we said, okay, maybe this water shouldn't be here. But after that, after these big structures, just look what we found. Okay, here you can see the different kind of stones. That's another characteristic of these drywalls. You can find different kind of granites, sandstone. All the other drywalls usually use the same material. In that case, we have different kind of stones used. The next one. Okay, look. So natural, of course. Okay, the next one. So, after the structures, we have found this channel for the water. As you can see, the water is totally clean. So before, in the other the previous pictures, it was dirty because we were walking. So when we start to walk, we just move the soil, and that's the reason why it was dirty. But if nobody touched the water, look, it's perfect. And we made some analysis, we took some samples, and actually the water is totally drinkable. So even if it's here for who knows how many thousands of years, you can drink it without any problem. So here it seems to be very, very big, but actually maximum it reached 1 meter and 20 centimeters.
So we have to walk in the channel, and we can go on only with the fisherman boots. So when we discovered this tunnel, we were very excited because everything was empty. We couldn't find the end of the tunnel. And I was thinking, maybe we have the entrance of the pyramid. And well, other pictures just to show you the tunnel. Here, exactly in the middle of the tunnel. Or another, the next one. Okay, here, as you can see, when the tunnel is curving, the channel for the water curves itself. Here, again, other picture. Inside we have other drywalls, so here one on the left and one on the right. Okay, those two pictures in order to show. Okay, the other one, the drywalls. So here, as you can see, we have the fill-up material, and well, it's a kind of tunnel that we know, a kind of drywall that we know very well, okay? And it's our picture under the water. So, as you can see, well, you cannot see perfectly the cut because actually you have to consider that a lot of material fell down during the time. And that's the reason why in the future, after the volunteering camp will finish, I would like to go inside and with the sand bags, I would like to try to create a block for the water after 2 meters from the beginning of the channel in order to empty the water just in that section and to study the structure, because now we don't know anything. It's under the water and it's very hard to work there. So that's the future plan. Okay, next. That's another one, you can see the curve of the tunnel. Next one. Okay, that's not the end. Well, after 120 meters, we found this this situation. What it means? It means that after 120 meters, we couldn't go deeper with the fisherman boats. It was impossible because we had only 20 centimeters in order to breathe. I didn't want to take the risk to be inside forever. So, I was trying to search on the internet, I was writing to everybody. Fortunately, I had the diving license. And I was writing, come on, just give us an equipment. I don't have the money to buy this equipment for diving. Can you just be a sponsor of us if you want to give us this equipment? I will dive, we will check, maybe we will go inside the pyramid. And of course, nobody answered. So I was waiting, everybody was waiting, I was very excited. And in April, finally, a group of Slovenian guys decided to come, and I had the chance to dive inside these tunnels. And it was an amazing day, crazy day, the water is very cold, but everybody was so excited. And after 120 meters, we started to dive. And unfortunately, we discovered that after 145 meters, there was the end of the tunnel. So we didn't go inside the pyramid. But, so, that's the end. In the future, as I told you, I will try to study this new structure, this cut for this channel for the water. As I told you before, I don't have answers. It's a challenge for me. Every day, we are trying to understand something. Every day we are trying to collect materials, to collect data, but it's very hard because from an archaeological point of view we are not finding so many artifacts. So for an archaeologist it's something impossible because we cannot dig the layers. But we are finding all these structures, and these structures are unique, so we cannot date them actually. So I will go on with the researches. I hope we will be able to understand something. One thing we realized that, well, if we found the channel for the water, it means that they wanted the water inside. So it's just a small piece of puzzle more inside this huge puzzle of physical civilization. And every day we are discovering something new. So we will see in the future. Of course, we need other archaeologists and other scientists. Samuel Osmanagic underlined that many times, but nobody's listening to us, so that's an invitation for everybody, just come here, help us, and well, thank you so much, we'll go on with my job.
Thank you so much. I wanted to say just a few words for the volunteers, because, well, as I told you, I'm alone here, and for the last two years, we are giving the chance to the volunteers all around the world to come here and work with us. And that's a great chance, I did the same last summer. So even if the result of the last shift and other six shifts are gone, I would like really to thank you so much from my heart, because we worked together, we created friendships, and it was amazing. That's the real treasure of Foundation. The pyramids, of course, but different people from different countries with different traditions are coming here, living together, working together, and it's something amazing. So thank you so much from my heart. It was a pleasure with you.
Sara, for your personal bravery and enthusiasm you bring in here, and all your smiles. Now, on October 1st, her contract will expire, 1 year contract. Are you going to keep her?
Yes!
Underground labyrinth. I mentioned after Paolo's talk that discovery of the structure can be one of the most important discoveries so far. However, discovery of the open sections of the underground artificial water accumulation is also extremely important. But maybe even more, the existence of the dry walls that are 10 meters plus in length will open some more questions. So far, we thought that the conglomerate was a natural deposit. However, if you have a dry wall 10 meters long that is sitting on the clay, and on the top of the dry wall is the conglomerate, and we can see the conglomerate ceiling, it seems that the dry wall was used as a support, like Sara and Ravne. Obviously, the dry walls are made by intelligent hand. There is a possibility this whole underground complex is not natural, at least in the section of the conglomerate, but that everything was artificial. In that case, it means that somebody in the distant past was able to manipulate, not with hundreds of times, or even thousands, but millions of times. We are in the present of extremely advanced cultures and civilizations.